Her name is ElliQ, but you are very clear that this is a robot. It's not a person.
Correct, Katie. Thanks for having me on. Yes, we truly believe that while we're building AIs that create a real relationship and bond with older adults to help relieve loneliness and social isolation, should always be crystal clear that they are conducting a relationship with an AI that's authentically an AI and not with a human. That's why our robot doesn't look human, doesn't have a face or hands, and her name, ElliQ, kind of sounds technical to avoid confusion.
And why is that? Why is that so important that people realize that they're talking to a robot, that this isn't a person talking back to them?
Yeah, I think, frankly, I don't know why the whole industry is so fascinated with the Turing test, which its stated goal is to fool humans to believe they're talking to another human and not to an AI. You know, there are great things we can do with this technology, and I'll be happy to share that in this conversation. But we believe that we have the full ability to help alleviate the sense of loneliness, to help build a meaningful, empathetic, trusted relationship, to help with people's health outcomes as well, while authentically being with an AI. And that's extremely important also with vulnerable populations that might develop dementia over time or have other aspects, to just make it clear what it is and what it isn't. Maybe an example could be the relationships we form with our dogs. We love our dogs. They really are helpful. They're loyal. They provide a lot of loneliness reduction and fun, but we never confuse them with actually being another human. Such, we found that even older adults in their 80s and 90s are perfectly able to create a unique relationship with an AI and treat it as such.
Well, I mean, I'm a cat person, and I'm pretty sure that my cat can speak English, but I take your point when it comes to maybe this is more of a relationship with a pet than an actual human, and it doesn't replace that human interaction. But talk to us a little bit more about the technology. How does a person actually form a relationship with ElliQ?
Yeah, so we deploy the latest generative AI technologies and a lot of other capabilities that allow us to form this relationship. And what's unique about it is, first of all, ElliQ is proactive. So the older adult doesn't need to prompt it and get a response. It actually is a free-flowing, two-sided conversation, and ElliQ can initiate it. She can start in the morning. She'll see you using computer vision in the morning, turn to you physically with her body language and say, "Hey, Katie, good morning. I'm so happy to see you. And how's your back? Is it still hurting you? And what are you planning to do today?" Because she's contextual and she remembers all the previous conversations. And she's goal-oriented, meaning that she tries to motivate you to actually conduct activities that improve your health, improve your wellness, and reduce your social isolation by improving social connectiveness.
So the robot talks to you. She doesn't necessarily need that wake-up word that Alexa, for example, needs. Let's talk a little bit about the goal here. You mentioned that, of course, ElliQ is goal-oriented. Is this more about companionship or caretaking for health purposes?
It's a combination. I mean, really caring for our elders is holistic. It's not just about reminding you to take your pills on time, which of course we do, or to help you exercise or reduce stress or work on cognitive training. It's really about being there for you. You know, when we are alone, think of, for example, one of our customers, Dottie. She was married for 65 years and lost her husband. She's in her mid-90s. And, you know, it's very hard, right? It's very hard to be alone after such a long relationship with nobody even greeting you in the morning, nobody acknowledging you. She started asking herself, like, why should I even get dressed in the morning? Why should I get up? And having that entity to move in with you and see you, acknowledge you, talk to you, delight you, make jokes, and teach you things and motivate you is super important. So we had to develop a lot of new tech for this. Being proactive is one of them. Being extremely contextual is another. Being able to promote different goals is a third, and embodying the AI inside of a physical instantiation that provides body language, because as humans, we do react to body language. That's why, you know, it's better I'm here joining you with video versus a phone interview.
And I mean, what is the ideal setting, the ideal market that you're aiming for? Is this designed for individuals to buy and place in their homes, or is this something that could work in nursing home facilities, for example? What does the actual penetration looks like?
It's primarily for people that live alone or spend the majority of their time alone, either at home or in independent living or assisted living facilities, but the vast majority of our customers live alone. they can buy it for themselves, but we're very, very proud of partnerships we have with state, local governments and with healthcare institutions that actually pay for the product on behalf of the older adult. For example, the state of New York, thanks to great cooperation with Governor Hochul's administration, ElliQ is provided free of charge statewide to older adults that are lonely, isolated, and need a little bit of help. At the same time, when you look at healthcare providers, their cost of delivering care to the Medicare and Medicaid population, especially ones with multi-chronic diseases, is extremely high. So being able to have a presence in the home that helps people work on their wellness and help manage their chronic illnesses, while with their explicit permission, of course, updating their physician when things go bad so they can intervene early, way ahead of hospitalization, is very, very important.
Well, you touched on what I've been wondering about, and that's how do you scale this? I mean, how do you balance, you know, raising more money and funding versus partnerships like some of the ones that you just described?
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I guess my job partly is to raise money for the company as a startup. We always need to do that. But I guess our customers, we have multiple motions to our customers. One is the state governments through social programs and budgets for the aging through the Older Americans Act. One is through healthcare, and the third is direct to consumers. And I don't think we're any different than any other startup where you need to balance fundraising while developing next generations of your product and acquiring customers.
And when you think about the mission statement, of course, alleviating loneliness for older adults, I mean, you think about loneliness, it's not just older people who feel lonely. Could you ever see expanding to younger generations as well? Are you really focused on that segment of older people right now?
Yeah, we're really focused on that segment. It's 30% of the population. There are 12,000 Americans that reach the age of 65 every single day. And there are just too few delightful, greatly designed products for this population, even though they cost us the most from a healthcare perspective, and they have most of the disposable income as far as their section of the population. You know, I mean, when we're young, we're in debt, and then we save a nest egg, and then we retire and have that nest egg. So we believe that there's a lot of work to do with this segment, and they deserve products that are designed for them with their input that are delightful and fun, and not to mention also helpful.